Hi, my name is Chris and this is Battle Nonsense. In today's video I want to tell you about my experience with the Ryzen 7 1800X and why I recently replaced it with a Core i7 8700K. But first I want to make clear that it is not my intention to hate on AMD or its Ryzen processors. Even though the 1800X turned out to be the wrong processor for me, this doesn't mean that it is a bad product or that the Ryzen platform is bad in general. So last year AMD forced Intel's hand when they released Ryzen, which again showed us that competition drives innovation. Even diehard Intel fans should be happy that AMD finally has strong desktop CPUs again, as Intel did drop the prices of their processors almost immediately after AMD announced their Ryzen lineup. So last year I read a lot about how great the Ryzen 7 1800X is for content producers, and according to many reviews and guides it was also good for gaming as you could easily overclock it to have all 8 cores run at 4.1 GHz. So back in September I decided to upgrade my workstation and move my Intel Core i7 6700K to my test PC, which was in desperate need of an upgrade as it struggled to achieve those high frame rates required for my netcode and input lag tests. So the 6700K has 4 cores and 8 threads. The base clock is 4 GHz and the maximum single core turbo boost is 4.2 GHz, but I had mine overclocked to run all 4 cores at 4.5 GHz. The 1800X has 8 cores and 16 threads with a base clock of 3.6 GHz and a maximum single core turbo of 4 GHz. I paired the 1800X with an ASUS Crosshair 6 Hero, 16 GB of 3200 DDR4 RAM from Gskill, and for cooling I used the Corsair H100i V2. So the 1800X has a lower clock speed than my 6700K, but it has twice as many cores and I thought that I should be able to get it to run at 4.2 GHz on all cores, as that was what I read online. The problem, however, was that I could not get it to run at more than 4 GHz on all cores. I followed a ton of guides, I tried many different settings and BIOS versions, and I increased the CPU voltage to a point where it was borderline safe. But even though the CPU temperatures were always in the green, I could not get my 1800X to run at more than 4 GHz. And I'm not talking about the system becoming unstable during some crazy benchmark. The system would freeze during video encoding or even gaming when I tried to run it at more than 4 GHz. So that was very disappointing. However, the bigger issue was that besides encoding videos with Vidcoder, I barely noticed a performance improvement compared to my 6700K. Multitasking was surely better, but Adobe Premiere, an example, did not really render much faster, neither did After Effects. I know that Ryzen depends on very fast RAM, but even after I tried different RAM modules and various settings, the situation did not change. Now, to be clear, I am not blaming AMD nor the Ryzen platform for this performance issue. The problem is that many applications don't run faster when you throw more cores at them. And this was the issue that I had. Depending on the game or the application, the 8 cores of the 1800X running at 4 GHz performed worse than my 6700K's 4 cores running at 4.5 GHz. So the problem is not the 1800X, but that I bought a CPU which had great multi-thread performance, while many, if not most, games and applications barely take use of 6 or more cores. Then, in December, I've had friends and subscribers who knew that I wasn't happy with the 1800X tell me about how great the Core i7-8700K is for gaming. However, with its 6 cores running at a base clock of 3.7 GHz, I was not sure how it could be that much better, especially as it did seem to run very hot, which limited its overclocking potential. But as it turns out, you can run the 8700K at 5 GHz on all cores at low temps if you dare to delid the CPU, which means that you remove the heat spreader and then replace the stock thermal grease with liquid metal, which lowers the CPU temperatures by about 20 degrees Celsius. So, after a lot of research, I eventually decided to get an 8700K, remove that heat spreader, and replace that poor stock thermal paste with Coollaboratory's Liquid Ultra. There are quite many Delid tools out there now, and the reason why I went for Dr. Delid was, well, it was available. Every other tool was out of stock and I didn't want to wait. So, how does this work? First of all, make sure that you read the manual that comes with the tool to avoid that you damage the CPU in the process. Once you remove the heat spreader, you then want to get rid of the seal and thermal grease left on the CPU and the heat spreader. Then you want to apply a new thermal compound, but do not use some other thermal paste, as that will not make a big difference. You must go for liquid metal like Coollaboratory's Liquid Ultra or Thermal Grizzly's Conductonaut. But before you start to apply the liquid metal, make sure that you read the manual of the product, as many come with a cleaning set and tools that help you apply the liquid metal. When you apply the liquid metal, make sure that you do not use too much of it, as that could then spill and shorten contacts on the CPU. Once you successfully applied the liquid metal, you want to put the heat spreader back on. Some people just put it into the socket and don't reseal it, others leave gaps when they apply the heat-resistant silicone. I decided to reseal it entirely like it was before. Then you have to put it back into the Delid tool, use the frame to position the heat spreader correctly, and apply some pressure on the heat spreader. You need to check the manual of the heat-resistant silicone to find out how long it takes to cure. Then I roughen up the top side of the heat spreader a bit, apply the liquid metal, and put the cooler back on. Please make sure that yours is not made of aluminum, as that will corrode when it comes in contact with liquid metal. So, I've had friends and subscribers tell me that my CPU temperature would come down by 20 degrees Celsius when I replaced a stock thermal compound with liquid metal. To be honest, I did not really think that this would be the case, because that's an insane improvement. So, on the left you can see that the 8700K ran at about 85 degrees Celsius while all 6 cores were maxed out by Vidcoder. And on the right you can see that with the stock thermal grease replaced by liquid metal, the CPU temperature did not only drop by 22 degrees while Vidcoder was encoding the exact same video, the fan speed of the Corsair H100 IV2 is now also 420 RPM lower, despite using the same preset as before. So that is indeed a very big improvement, which then also allowed me to run the 8700K at 5 GHz for the past month. But how does that affect the performance? The open source software Blender is very good at maxing out all cores during rendering. The 6700K overclocked to 4.5 GHz finished a BMW benchmark in 7 minutes 42 seconds. The 1800X overclocked to 4 GHz on all 8 cores did it in 4 minutes 34 seconds, so it's a lot faster. However, the 8700K overclocked to 5 GHz on all 6 cores finished it in 4 minutes 36 seconds, which means that it's not really slower. So that's an application that can take use of all the 1800X's 8 cores. But what if you have an application that can only use 6 cores? How big is the difference between the 1800X and the 8700K then? To simulate that, I disabled 2 cores on the 1800X, which turned it into a 6-core CPU like the 8700K. Now the 8700K is 1 minute and 23 seconds faster than the 1800X. This shows how the performance per core becomes a very big factor when an application does not take use of all cores provided by the CPU. This becomes even more evident when I let Blender use just 4 cores on the 1800X and the 8700K, as even the 6700K with its 4.5 GHz is now 1 minute and 9 seconds faster than the 1800X. So, when you are about to buy a new CPU, then you really have to think about what kind of software you will run on it, because in many cases core speed will trump core count, especially in gaming. So, after I used the 8700K for more than 1 month, I've got to say that I'm very happy with its performance during gaming, video editing, video encoding, and multitasking. The Delid process is a bit scary, but if you follow the manual of the Delid tool, then it's not that hard nor risky, unless you are a very clumsy person. The overclocking is also quite easy, as I ended up only increasing the multiplier to 50 and the CPU core voltage to 1.35. I did get my 8700K to run at 5.1 GHz, but for that I had to increase the voltage to 1.4, which I didn't feel comfortable with, so I decided to stick with 5 GHz. I also tried the various presets that are built into the ASUS Maximus X Apex, but I found that some of these actually made the system less stable at 5 GHz, so I only have the multiplier set to 50 and the CPU voltage fixed at 1.35, as that works very well for me. One thing that I noticed while testing the various presets is that if a preset changes the AVX negative offset to anything but zero, then the CPU would not run at 5 GHz on all cores when I used VidCoder to encode a video with X265. So if you overclocked your CPU and wonder why it will sometimes not run all cores at the speed that you set, then this might be why. However, if you change the AVX negative offset to zero, then you should really keep an eye on the CPU temperature and make sure that you have a very good cooling solution to avoid that you run into thermal throttling. So that was my journey from the 6700K to the 1800X and finally a Delid and overclocked 8700K that I'm very happy with. Last week I then also sold the 1800X and the mainboard, which made my wife very happy as this whole upgrade project got a little bit more expensive than planned. But again, the 1800X is a very good processor, you just need to have the right kind of workload to really benefit from all its 8 cores. As we just learned a few days ago, AMD will soon launch updated Ryzen processors, which are hopefully able to compete with the current and upcoming Intel CPUs, as that will provide all of us with better, faster, and reasonably priced processors in the future. And that's all that I have got for you today. Let me know in the comments down below if you also tried to delete a CPU and how that worked for you, or if you now feel tempted to try it out. Also, stay tuned for my netcode analysis of Escape from Tarkov and Battalion 1944. If you enjoy my videos, then it would be great if you could support me on Patreon, as YouTube's ad revenue is sadly not enough anymore to run a niche channel like mine. Without the awesome support that I get from my patrons, Battle Nonsense would not exist anymore. You can find a link to my Patreon in the description down below, where you can also find links to my social accounts in case that you want to stay up to date on the videos that I'm working on. So if you enjoyed this video, then please give it a like, subscribe for more, and I hope to see you next time. Until then, have a nice day and take care. My name is Chris, and this was Battle Nonsense.